Jacob and Amanda exit, why it's going to be congregational singing, and it's The Lord Bless You, which is number 631, and A Common Love, which is 842. So if you want to either write those down or mark it in the songbook, that's fine, and most of you might have it memorized. 631 and 842. This is one happy day for Jacob and Amanda. It's been a while in coming, but it's here. It's a happy day for Mike and Cheryl. And it's a happy day for Daniel and Tina. It's also a happy day for the grandparents. It's a happy day for the sisters, for the brother-in-laws, and for all the extended families. A happy day. Not only are Jacob and Amanda uniting today, but we're uniting the Bruning family and the Couch family together. Don't know whether this is appropriate, Mike, or not, but I just got to thinking, since this is the third child, and most couches are three-cushion couches. We are going from a three-cushion couch to a love seat. Because special friends and family are standing with Jacob and Amanda today. And if you'll notice in your program, there is one member missing. And that member is Stephen. Stephen is in military training at Ranger School and could not be here. But he is with us, I'm sure, in spirit, and we need to remember him as well. Also, a grandmother, Patty, is not with us, as she has been with her sister, who is failing, and so we need to remember Patty as well. At this time, I would like for us to go to our, and your sister, that's right, is not here as well, and so we need to remember her, and that's Natasha. Is that right? Okay. Let's bow as we go to our Father in prayer, please. Our Father in God in heaven, we come to you in prayer as we give you thanks for such a beautiful day. We give you thanks for a beautiful couple that are joining their lives together today with Jacob and Amanda. We just pray that you would be with them. We pray that you would be with their families. At this time, we pray that you would be with Stephen, be with all of our military and our military families. We ask that you be with Patty as well as she's dealing with her sister. We just thank you for each and every one that is here. Father, we just pray that you would bless Jacob and Amanda's home. Bless them as they bless you. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Jacob, I have a question for you this time. Do you love Amanda with all your heart? And will you promise to take care of her no matter what the situation? And are you ready for Amanda to become your wife? And Amanda, I have a question for you. Do you love Jacob with all of your heart, and do you promise to take care of him no matter what the situation, and are you ready for Jacob to become your husband? Yes. Mike, because of their promises, and to you and your family and the Bruning family, but who gives Amanda to be married to Jacob?
Her mother and I.
Okay, bless your heart. We know that marriage is a great relationship. And when we really think about the greatest relationship between God and Jesus, and God and Jesus, and then the church, and then mankind, and how wonderful God has made mankind, think about your marriage relationship, not just today, but throughout your years to come. We're reminded of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 8. And I'm going to paraphrase because I want to say what love is, and I want to say what love isn't according to 1 Corinthians 13. It says, love is patient, and love is kind. Love protects, it trusts, it hopes, it perseveres. But what love is not, it is not envious, it is not boastful, it is not proud, it is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not angered, and it keeps no records of wrongs, and it never fails. Love is not just talking the talk, but love is walking the walk. At the first part of 1 Corinthians 13, it tells us, if we do not have love, we do not have nothing. Okay? I would like to read from the book of Ephesians, chapter 5. Wives, submit to your husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to take her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle, or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For he who loves his wife loves himself. And this is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Also in 1 Corinthians 7, which we talked about the other night in our sessions together, Paul writes, you no longer belong to yourselves, but you also belong to your spouse. So take care of each other in all aspects of life. In the book of Philippians, chapter 4 and verse 8, says, whatever is true, whatever is honest, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, and whatever is admirable, do. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 14, over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. 2 Peter chapter 1, starting with verse 5, add to your faith goodness, to goodness knowledge, to knowledge self-control, self-control perseverance, and perseverance godliness, and godliness brotherly kindness, and brotherly kindness love. Peter writes, if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So think about that, because as you build your lives together over the coming weeks, months, and years, remember that it's just to get better and better and better. At this time, Jacob, you have a covenant that you want to share with Amanda and to this audience.
Amanda. timing has not always been what we wanted. You took a couple weeks to say yes to go out with me, and then I know you were ready for the proposal months before I was. But I know today is the day the timing is perfect. We are here and ready, and this moment is right. The time is ready. The time is right in order for us to spend the rest of our lives together, and I'm excited for our lives to begin.
And Amanda, you have a covenant that you would like to share with Jacob.
I'm so excited to say it's finally here.
Yeah.
I've waited a really long time to become your wife. Jacob, there's so many things I admire about you. Your hard work, your dreams, your goals, how you have a vision for life. And I thank God for that cooking class at Penn State where we became class partners. It wasn't much time after that we were inseparable and best of friends. And that is what I love. Today, I marry my best friend. I have no doubt in my mind that you will protect me, sacrifice for me, provide for me, be loyal and faithful to me. Jacob, I will do the same for you. I know that with Christ with us, we can get through anything. I love you.
Thank you. Before we repeat our vows, one of the things that is important, at least to me, in a situation like this with a marriage ceremony, is the term accountability. And that's part of your covenants to each other and also your vows to each other. And it's up to each one of us to help each other make you all accountable for those promises. One of the things that the scriptures teach us is if you're not going to keep a promise, if you're not going to keep a vow, what does it say? Don't make it. So you're making that, commitment. Here we go. Mr. Jacob, repeat if you would. I, Jacob, take you, Amanda.
I, Jacob, take you, Amanda.
To be my wife. To have and to hold from this day forward. For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer or poor.
For richer or poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Until death do us part. Miss Amanda. I, Amanda, take you, Jacob.
I, Amanda, take you, Jacob.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold from this day forward,
for better or worse,
for richer or poor,
in sickness and in health,
to love and
cherish,
until death do us part.
Now, something else I want to mention before we do the rings. Last night, it was interesting to me because of family setting some precedents. Went to Grandpa and Grandma. How long have you been married? 57 years. To Grandma and Grandpa, how long have you been married? 56 years. So you've got that example set before you. How did they do it? Well, as Grandpa said, never go to bed angry. And as Grandma said, we have sometimes. Admittance is very important. Admittance is very important. You have some example in front of you. With your mom and dad, and others. Are there rings to share with this? All right. Jacob, as you will place her ring on her finger, please repeat. That with this ring I be wed,
with this ring I be wed,
as a symbol of our everlasting love. As you place the ring on Jacob's finger, with this ring I be with, as a symbol of our everlasting love. Would you please observe your rings? And as customary with me, I would like everyone in the audience, if you will, to observe the ring on your finger. Last evening, when we were talking about the rings, and I think it was Tina that said about the groomsmen, you notice they do not have rings. Well, we who have rings, it's a special ring. And it's there for our lifetime, but it's there for the world to know that we have a special person in our lives. Wear that ring with pride. Take care of it because of the symbol that it is. At this time, I want to talk about the cross that Jacob and Amanda are going to assemble. It's called a unity cross, ladies and gentlemen. It's a beautiful sculpture that they will have in their home to remind them of the covenant that they have made today. Genesis chapter 1, God created man in his own image, and he created man to be bold and strong and the leader, a protector of his wife and family. So Tina, if you will, this outer form, ladies and gentlemen, represents the strength, the leadership, and the protection of the man. In Ephesians 5, which we read a while ago, it reminds husbands to love their wives as Christ loved the church and to completely give himself for her. And Cheryl, the bride's piece in Genesis chapter 2 tells us that the woman was made from man. The bride's piece represents the beauty and the many capabilities of the woman. The helpmeet, designed with intricate, beautiful detail and placed inside the protection of the cross, completing the sculpture and representing the two becoming one. And to complete the sculpture, representing Jacob and Amanda's covenant, we will place three pegs holding it together. The three pegs represent the Father and the Son. And the Holy Spirit. Showing God's place in the covenant and the completeness that only God can give. And as I think both grandmothers suggested last evening, marriage takes three. And that's the groom, that's the bride, and our God. The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verse 12, tells us that three strands is not easily broken. Matthew 19 says, "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh." Jacob and Amanda will no longer be two, but one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate.
I cross my heart and promise to give all I've got to give to make all your dreams come true.
I
can't emphasize enough the meaning of oneness. One of the things about God when he brought Jesus to this world, to live, to die, but yet to be raised again. And one of the things that Jesus said, my Father and I are one. And he says, if you knew the Father, you would know me. So as you live your lives together through the years, just keep that in mind and be one, not only with each other, but with Jesus Christ and God. At this time, the roses for your mother. For as much as Jacob and Amanda have promised together in holy matrimony and have witnessed before God and us present, and that as they have pledged their love one to another, I now pronounce you husband and wife. And finally, you may kiss your bride.
I'm Alex Stout. I've known Jake pretty much my whole life. We've gone through kindergarten all the way up to high school. But I just wanted to say a couple things. Mainly, Jake, you're starting a new portion of your life, and I wish you two the best of luck. Amanda, good luck. I just want to say a little story. And me and Jake, we were thick and thin through football, all through middle school and high school. But I was a guard on the offensive line, and Jake was a fullback. And we had this thing where we had to do a trap, where the opposite guard had to go trap and block for the fullback. I hated doing it because I'd always seem to fall down. I thought maybe I was just clumsy. You know, I was like, dang it, I'm really bad at this. After senior year, after football is finally over, Jake comes up to me and says, I really loved it when you guys, you know, did those traps for me. Because I could just grab you by the back and just throw you whatever way I needed to do. And I was like, okay, well, thanks. So out of that little story, you know, Amanda, I think of you as the fullback now. And he's the guard. Just take him wherever you need him to go. Thank you.
Life together, and I'm so happy for you. And I don't want you to put